It's been 6 months since Pearl Harbor. The Japanese, aware of growing US naval armaments and that their window of opportunity for victory was running out, are completing preparations for another offensive to secure Midway Atoll as an advanced staging area for operations in the Central Pacific. Once secure, the Japanese fleet would lie in wait to ambush and decisively destroy the American relief forces. Unfortunately for the Japanese, American hypo-crypto analysts under Joseph Rochefort were working 36-hour stints via the use of Benzedrine to decipher Japanese naval codes. Unable to confirm the target of the attack, known only by its codename AF, one of Rochefort's subordinates, Jasper Holmes, suggested sending fake messages about the failure of water supply on Midway Island in both unencrypted and captured ciphers known to the enemy. The Japanese took the bait. Within hours, they broadcast instructions to load additional water and desalination equipment for AF, and subsequent decrypts would confirm the dates of the operation. So it was that both fleets set sail for battle, but it was the Americans who would have the chance to ambush. Japanese deployments for Operation Mi, the attack on Midway, were deeply flawed and adversely affected by internal Japanese politics, unsound doctrine, miscommunications, and faulty intelligence. The Japanese erroneously believed that the Americans had only 4 to 5 operational fleet carriers. Furthermore, the American Admiral Nimitz had cunningly deceived the Japanese by ordering Admiral Halsey to sail his carriers Enterprise and Hornet, where they could be easily observed by the enemy east of the Solomon Islands, then allowed the Japanese reconnaissance aircraft to escape and report back to base. This deception was followed by creating false radio traffic, while the carriers themselves headed north under relative radio silence. As a result, Japanese intelligence wrongly reported up till 4 days before the attack that the US carriers remained in the South and not Central Pacific. Additionally, militarily unsound political wrangling over strategic priorities driven by the inter-service rivalry between Army and Navy, combined with the theoretically sound desire for a diversionary attack, led to the fateful decision to divide Japanese forces for a simultaneous attack on the Aleutian Islands, which meant that the slow escort carriers Junyo and Rujo would be absent along with their escort fleets. Furthermore, the insistence by Yamamoto to maximize surprise meant that the fleet would have to be split into a fast force under Chuichi Nagumo and a slow main force under the command of Yamamoto himself, along with an amphibious assault force of Marines moving up from the South Pacific to capture Midway itself. These elements, however, would be too far apart to effectively support each other. Left behind entirely was the fast carrier Zuikaku, since no replacement pilots were available, despite the fact that a composite air group could easily have been created by combining the surviving air groups from Shoho and Shokaku. This refusal was likely based on the doctrinal emphasis that carrier air groups should only ever operate from a single ship. Infiltrating behind Midway in advance was a force of submarines to set up a screen along the most direct route to Midway from Hawaii, around the French frigate Shoals. From here, they could also rendezvous with and refuel reconnaissance float planes for Operation K, a reconnaissance mission over Pearl Harbor to warn the fleet of any American reinforcements and understand the disposition of American carriers. These subs, however, did not have adequate time to arrive in position, allowing the American fleet to slip through undetected while the shoals were found to be occupied by American warships. After the fleet set sail for Midway, the powerful antennae of the main fleet's flagship Yamato picked up a warning from Japanese naval headquarters about a spike in American signal traffic in the Central Pacific, along with a notification that Operation K had been aborted, and unable to confirm the location of the American carriers. Later, Yamato detected a suspicious signal coming from the vicinity of their assault force. Despite Nagumo's chief of staff asking that any intelligence be relayed via the main force due to the chance of transmission loss, Yamamoto's own chief of staff advised against this in order to maintain radio silence, despite the fact that there was increasing evidence that supplies had been lost, and therefore radio silence was now pointless. Indeed, Nagumo's flagship Akagi was too far away to detect the faint signals being sent from the Japanese mainland, since she lacked the high superstructure and large antenna needed for such long-distance communications. A critical failure was made in failing to ask the Kongo-class battleships in his fleet, which did have high superstructures, to act as radio relays. So it was that when Nagumo briefed his subordinates with the remarks that surprise would be on their side, the irony would be that the man most surprised by the battle would be Nagumo himself. And now to the Americans. Japanese uncertainty over the number of available American carriers was understandable. The Yorktown had been heavily damaged during the Battle of the Coral Sea and left for battle with repairs still ongoing, driven by Admiral Fletcher's insistence on joining the battle. And unlike the Japanese, she easily mustered a full complement of pilots and planes by integrating the Coral Sea survivors from Lexington. Hornet and Enterprise, under Spruance, arrived undetected to the north of the island. As for the American submarines, they would borrow from their Japanese counterparts by setting up a defensive screen in front of Midway, where one of the subs would observe and report the size and course of the invasion force. In addition to the American fleet, there were also squadrons of fighter, dive bomber, torpedo bomber, and B-17 long-range bombers available on Midway Island itself. In total, the Americans would field 233 carrier-based aircraft and 127 land-based aircraft to oppose 248 carrier-based aircraft and 16 float planes of the Japanese. So, that was the story of the Battle of Midway, or at least the lead up to it. Now, A-History takes over, but if you'd like to learn more about it, I would love it if you looked at some of the sources I post. It really was a remarkable battle, with everything from things coming down to sheer luck to desertion into the face of the enemy to go punch them in the face by a rather unique American pilot by the name of Waldron. And you should really look that guy up. He was, I believe, a Congressional Medal of Honor winner. But this is my ahistorical battle of the Battle of Midway. So as you can see, I'm heading south. Historically, the US fleet did head south, but never as far as Midway itself. Furthermore, I've gone light on my submarine screening force in order to focus on adding an additional carrier. And what I'm planning to do is shuttle my planes from the north, have them land on my carrier to the south of Midway, and essentially press just a continuing attack on the Japanese. I'm also not looking to hold back or do any kind of pure airstrikes. This is going to turn into a decisive naval battle. The Japanese wanted the Kantai Kessen, and boy oh boy am I going to give it to them. So here we are. Dive bombers and torpedo bombers have engaged the Japanese amphibious assault force. These were very elite marine forces who historically would go on to fight in the Battle of Guadalcanal. But I'm afraid I'm not going to let them off. They're not going to get away this time. As you can see, I'm moving my destroyers down south. I'm trying to flank the main force and dislocate the Japanese destroyer line. I'm going to focus onto the destroyers first. At the moment in the north, I am just trying to deal with and whittle down the bombers attacking Midway Island itself with naval anti-aircraft fire. And then once that's done, I'm hoping to engage with my my fighters, my Wildcats, and my land-based interceptors. Come on, launch a missile, do some damage. Okay, so they didn't have missiles yet. At least not guided air-to-air missiles. Another one bites the dust. Interesting bit of trivia. The Japanese often did not wear parachutes because they felt that if you wore a parachute, then you were expecting to get shot down. Also for the more sort of pragmatic reason that it did make the flying the plane in a Zero's cramped cockpit a bit more difficult. But it did contribute very significantly to the loss of experienced Japanese pilots. Because if you were shot down, then that was kind of it. Unless you managed to very skillfully ditch into the sea, which wasn't always possible in a damaged aircraft, then, you know, that was your death right there. Continuing on, my destroyer escort screens are just having a good time. Never mind that the carrier fleet is completely leaving. Well, and here's a counter-attack on my dive bombers. Getting a little bit of AA fire there. Now, historically, the Southern Force was actually escorted by two Congo-class battleships, which, as far as I can tell, are nowhere to be found. It would have been nice if I had to fight the Congos, but then it would also make my job quite impossible in terms of a naval battle. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to swing my entire force down south. And then once all my naval forces have successfully linked up, it's going to be battle time. As you can see, I'm trying very hard to detect any screening Japanese destroyers. Historically, they were all far to the east, but it is a relatively small map. I kind of wish that they had made it a little bit bigger, made sort of acquiring the enemy a bit more of a challenge, but it is as it is. As you can see, the Japanese doing much worse than they historically did. The AA fire from my cruisers has helped, as has the just astounding number of carrier-based aircraft fighters. I imagine the Japanese are wondering what exactly happened to all their lead elements, and why they never made it back to the carrier. Got my Catalina flying boats heading out, trying to get eyes on everything. Historically, the Catalina would start getting phased out after this battle. They were just a bit too slow to deal with the later Japanese fighters and anti-aircraft. They were very well armed, but they were big, bulky, and slow. And while they were very resilient to fire for the most part, it doesn't really matter if there's an entire Japanese squadron going after you. some good shots on the light cruiser, but I'm not going to find them, so I'm just going to keep hitting the destroyers and finish it off with the bombers. And it's actually an interesting thing, because you'd think that by knocking out the kind of outer guns on a warship with naval gunfire, you could basically render it very difficult for it to defend itself then against airstrikes, because the anti-aircraft guns tended to be unarmored, open, and highly exposed. But I've honestly not been able to find any real examples of battles where sort of light ships were able to knock out AA guns and then bombers came in to finish the job. So if anyone could mention that, please reference it. I'd love to do a kind of mini documentary on it. And I am trying to get a little bit more into the documentary style for all of these battle reports. I'm trying to make a little less quantity in content and a little bit higher quality. Although that is a bit problematic because it takes me about a day at a time to get that done. And it begins, the Kantai Kessen. Historically, the Japanese main fleet was several hundred miles behind their strike force and were unable to participate in the Battle of Midway. But here they are, and bring it on. So here we are. In addition to the Yamato, there are the battleships Nagato and her sister ship Mutsu. Whoops, wrong images. Thank you. Thank you. the Yamato is just decimating ship after ship. And it's down to one health too. That is just... that is a powerful warship. This is how it was supposed to fight, winning surface battles. It's my own fault for arming bombs rather than torpedoes. We'll get this thing. We are gonna finally sink the Yamato. We're losing destroyer after destroyer, sinking to the bottom of the seas, but we are gonna get the Yamato. We are gonna get the carriers. They're gonna regret ever coming to Midway. This is for Pearl, people. This is for Pearl Harbor. Here comes the Tambor. Yamato destroyed! Following an enormous explosion and column of black smoke, the Yamato, pride of the Japanese Navy and largest battleship in the world, has been destroyed.